everyone. Happy Friday. We made it to the end of the week, still relatively sane. I'm going to put that down to the power of community, which is why I'm so grateful that you are here with me. As always, I have a jam-packed show for you. The heads of NATO Africa, as well as CDC Africa, have all been sounding the alarm of a health catastrophe potentially facing Africa due to the coronavirus. Today, I'm going to bring you a slightly different view. We have a doctor in the house, an epidemiologist, no less, who's going to explain to you why he thinks that, you know, it may not be, you know, pandemonium, if you will, on the continent due to COVID-19. He'll share his thoughts. We're also going to look at the economic could Saharan Africa be approaching a recession. That would be the first time in 25 years. The head of McKinsey Africa will be here to break down the numbers for us. Also, a number of nonprofit organizations have been forced to halt their work because of coronavirus. But we're going to introduce you to one supermodel who basically said that was not an option for her and her organization in DRC. She'll explain to you why she's still on the ground and still helping people. She is our everyday hero. And finally, it's Friday, but every day we try and bring you the bright side. I want you to guess who's on the show. I'm going to give you a clue. He's building a dynasty. That's all I'm going to say. See if you can figure it out and send me your answers. We've got that and so much more. Let's jump right in. All right. So just a couple of days ago, the World Health Organization was sounding the alarm, or basically letting us know that the world was approaching a million cases globally of coronavirus. Since then, we have passed that threshold, long past it. The total number now in the world is 1,650,000 plus and surging. Those numbers are growing across the world, including in Africa, where we're now seeing more than 12,000 confirmed cases and more than 700 lives lost. So it is spreading. The question is, how fast is it spreading on the continent? When we look across the 54 countries, only two countries are yet to confirm an outbreak of the coronavirus, Lesotho and Comoros, and also to mention the disputed territory of Western Sahara. So where is this thing going? How far is it into local populations? We have an epidemiologist with us, Dr. Moses Katabawa. He's also an adjunct professor at Emory University in Atlanta, and he joins us now. Dr. Katabawa, can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Welcome. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
So we've heard just in the last few days, we've heard from the head of Africa's CDC, we've heard from the head of WHO Africa that the worst is still to come when it comes to the continent and the spread of coronavirus there. You see things slightly differently. You don't see it as a kind of a foregone conclusion that this catastrophe is coming. Tell me why.
Well, I don't want to sound as if I'm underestimating the impact of the transmission of coronavirus and COVID-19. However, I want what is being done on the African continent to be recognized and credit to be put where it should. If you look at when the coronavirus started spreading in January, February, Europe was, it was business as usual. USA, business as usual. Some extent at the beginning, China, business as usual. Africa was not business as usual. The moment they had that, they knew that they don't have the resources and everything to contain this now pandemic, and they started putting in policies, regulations to keep the transmission at bay. And that's why we find maybe the country with the most cases is South Africa, which I see this morning is is about 2003, and maybe it may increase a bit. Then you, it's the countries in North Africa, Egypt, Algeria, Morocco, and then maybe mid and the Central Africa is Cameroon, which is about 600, above 600. But all these other countries have contained this transmission. They are put in place, mechanisms to keep the transmission at bay. They have, some of them have closed, actually many of them now have closed their borders, and they have put facilities at the border entry points. They have mobilized their populations, and those that were found to be positive have been isolated and quarantined, either in institutional quarantine or self-isolation in their homes. And actually, the spread is not as what people thought it would be.
So let me jump in there right now, because I do want to bring you up to speed with what WHO Africa Chief Dr. Matshidiso Moeti said just a couple of hours ago, I think about a day or so ago. She said that clusters of community transmission have emerged in at least 16 countries. That means the virus has begun spreading beyond the initial cases imported from abroad. Case numbers are increasing exponentially in the African region. She also said this: it took 16 days from the first confirmed case in the region to reach 100 cases. It took a further 10 days to reach the first 1,000. 3 days after this, there were 2,000 cases, and 2 days later, we were at 3,000. What do you say to that?
I would want to say that Africa is a continent. It's not a country. And so we need to look at Africa by country, by region, by provinces. And what I see in East Africa is not what is being what people are saying. I still want to say again that I will not underestimate the swift spread of rather transmission of coronavirus, but and it's not good to say things are okay at this point. No, they are not okay, and wherever there is a case and it's not well detected, within a week, we'll see a huge change in the community. But let's say that this is the time for Africa to be recognized for what has been achieved in the last 2 months, when the transmission in USA is just, the speed is something we have never seen. In Europe, something we had never seen. In Africa, it does not mean that movement of people had stopped, but there is a way in which African governments dealt with the issue and minimized the impact, the problem now we see in Europe or in USA.
Okay, but very quickly, because I'm sadly out of time, I do want to ask you very quickly, what more needs to be done? Because yes, again, I'm with you. I'm applauding the swift action taken by African leaders. It's absolutely noteworthy, but clearly more needs to be done because this still is spreading. So for you as an epidemiologist, what does that need to be? Is it the same as everyone else? More testing, more contact tracing, isolation?
More of everything of what the African governments are doing, but we need also to set up testing points across the countries in different regions. I am glad that in Uganda they have about 100 testing points across the country, and whenever they take samples, they reach there is one lab near Entebbe in Kampala, which at the Virus Institute, where they test this, and it gets there within 1 day. So I would, Uganda is a small country, but if we talk about Nigeria and other countries, the size is big, and we need to look at that and make sure we have proper laboratory facilities and testing points in different regions.
So go ahead, last word, go ahead.
Also, the isolating cases, positive cases, or people coming in the country, stopping public transportation in the country, because that's where transmission will be, will escalate. And of course, telling people to wash, to use masks, and teaching them how to make the face masks locally, not depending on, and washing with soap.
Yeah.
Forget hand sanitizers, which people are promoting. They are not available in the rural areas, not even in the urban areas, but soap, any soap is okay.
Dr. Moses Kasbah, it's great to get your perspective on the show today. Thank you so much. We're going to check in with you as the situation develops and get your view on the numbers and what's happening on the ground. Dr. Moses Kasbah there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Okay. You're very welcome. Right. So you heard there from the doctor that he's not underestimating what's happening on the continent. Any case of coronavirus is serious, but he feels that, you know, we've seen a robust action, and I don't think that's disputable. We have seen robust action on the parts of many African governments. Excuse me. The question just has to be now: how do we escalate that response? How do we broaden it so that we can get the situation under control? Because the fact of the matter is, the head of Africa CDC is warning, has said in the last few days, that the worst is still yet to come in Africa. So the question is, how do we abate that that surge? How do we protect our populations? That is the question we'll be putting to experts and government leaders in the days ahead. So many lives have already been lost to coronavirus right around the world. And in Africa, we've already said to you, I said at the top of the show, almost 700 people have died. We feel it's important here on Home with Aisha to say, to acknowledge the loss, to acknowledge the fact that people are losing their lives in this moment to COVID-19. And we feel it's important to highlight the Africans amongst the thousands, the tens of thousands of people who have died. We want to highlight two Sudanese doctors who lost the fight against COVID-19. Dr. Adil El Taya and Dr. Amged El Harani were both doctors in the UK's National Health Service. They had both retired, but they came back voluntarily to help assist the country through the pandemic. Dr. El Taya helped establish a transplant program in his native home of Sudan. His family told the BBC, Adil was someone who was central to our family, who was well respected by so many people. Dr. El Harani, who worked at Queen's Hospital in Burton, was one of the first senior medics in the UK to die after contracting the disease. His family said in a statement, he was a loving and much loved husband, son, father, brother, and friend. His greatest passions were his family and his profession, and he dedicated his life to both. Our hearts and prayers are with the families of these doctors and, of course, everyone who has passed on due to COVID-19. Well, when we talk about this pandemic, we are, of course, talking about its health impact. But this is really, it's really a twofold disaster when we're talking about Africa, or particularly acutely a twofold crisis in Africa. You know, we're worried about the health situation, but we're also worried about the economic toll this will take on the countries there. The data right now is pointing to a recession. It's pointing to a recession in sub-Saharan Africa, the first in 25 years. We wanted to get a full picture of what Africa is potentially facing on the economic front. So I spent some time talking to the head of McKinsey Africa, Achaleke, to get his take. Take a listen. Acha, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Let me start by asking you to sum up your view of the economic fallout Africa is facing as a result of this pandemic.
Yeah. No, I mean, unfortunately, we're facing quite a significant fallout. We just ran some numbers to understand the impact on GDP across Africa. We looked at four scenarios, one where it's basic global transmission versus Africa transmission. You can imagine the best case is you figure out how to control it in the US and in Europe, and it's contained in Africa. Worst case is there's a resurgence in Asia. We struggle in Europe and US, and Africa becomes a widespread. And there's only one, and by the way, Africa faces three crises. We talk about the pandemic, but there's a global pandemic, there's an Africa pandemic, and then there's oil, right? So it faces three crises. So there's only one scenario under which we still have a positive growth, and that's, you know, the first scenario, if it's really well contained. It's looking less and less likely, obviously, across Africa. Under every other scenario, we go into recession. And I think it's very likely that Africa will experience, as a continent, its first recession in 25 years, unfortunately.
How, I know you've modeled it against these different scenarios. How soon will people begin to feel that impact?
Yeah. Well, no, people are already feeling it, right? So we have, and the reality is, you know, people who feel it the most are the SMEs, mm-hmm. right? People who work for SMEs, because, you know, it's hard for them to maintain. And the vulnerable, right? So we project that we could see, just even in salaried paid employees, probably 20 million job losses. You can imagine in the vulnerable, imagine the tourism sector across Africa for the rest of the year, potentially, right? You look at the construction sector, right? So even in the non-salaried employees, people who live sort of, you know, every day, they have to earn their living every day. You can imagine the impact it has there. So it's going to be a massive, massive impact. And, you know, that's why it's important for us to really try to contain it, right? And our message is we need to be a lot more bolder in our actions. We need to be a lot more urgent. I just don't feel there's enough urgency we see across many of our countries.
So talk to me about that, about what, in your view, would constitute a bold, decisive action plan. Where are they falling down now? What needs to be stepped up?
I mean, there are a number of things. One is how, just so basically, you have a health crisis and an economic crisis, right? So you have some countries who said, look, you know, South Africa said a national lockdown. That is very, you know, that's very clearly important for the health crisis. It does have a big impact on the economy, right? So all of our countries are trying to figure out, how do you balance the two? Like somebody said, you can have a 10% chance of dying of corona or 100% chance of dying of hunger, right? Yeah. What do you choose? And it's not an easy answer. That's why it's not an easy answer for our government, right? They're thinking about it. But I think, you know, we need a lot more testing. There's no question about it. We need a lot more testing going on, to give you a sense. We have about 11,500 cases in Africa, at least this morning. That's what we had. But if you look at, you know, South Africa is, you know, almost close to 2,000. Nigeria is probably in the 300. But Nigeria has done probably less than 3,000 tests. South Africa has done 50,000 tests, mm-hmm. right? So we're just not doing enough testing to really understand the extent of the situation. We need a lot of support from our bilateral partner and multilateral partners. So the $100 billion package that our African finance minister have asked for, you know, some people think it's not enough. We actually don't think it's enough. And I think they agree it's not enough. We need even more. We're going to need a lot of support. We don't have $2 trillion to pump into the economy. Right? So we're going to need a lot of support from bilateral partners. And then we need our citizens to take it seriously, right? When they say social distancing, we all have to take social distancing seriously, because that's how you flatten the curve.
When it comes to this issue of suspension of debt payments, which a lot of people are calling for, how much of a boost would it be to the effort of blunting the economic shock to the continent?
Yeah, just to give you a sense, I mean, if you look at the fiscal packages that our governments have announced today, it's about 1.5 to 4% of GDP. We think we need about 10%, right? So there's a gap there that has to then be, you know, filled by some of these measures, right? So for the debt relief, you know, African countries this year were going to pay $44 billion in debt servicing costs. $44 billion.
$44 billion
this year. So there's a big request to say, let's have a moratorium on that debt. Not let's cancel it, right? Let's just have a moratorium, at least for now. Now, and hopefully that's going to get approved, right? But the question there is, let's say we get that moratorium. What do we do with the money, right? Do the countries then use that money to pay off debt on the euro bonds they issued, which is more private debt? Is that the right thing to do with it? Do they use it to actually pump it into the economy as a stimulus? And if they do that, how do they do it? If they give it to an SME or to a business, how do you make sure that that business uses it to actually continue to pay their employees, right? And not use it for other reasons, right? So it's actually not an easy decision. These are all trade-offs that need to be made, but that has to be resolved. What we know we need to protect jobs. And we need to protect our vulnerable people of the population. That we know we need to do. And we need to help, you know, on the health front as well.
Are you worried about social stability? Because, you know, again, you've done the modeling, you've done four scenarios. They're all pretty bad. I mean, there's a hit. The question is how deep, how long? Are you worried about social stability, you know, in places on the continent?
No, there is a risk, right? There is a risk. On the first, you know, people are saying, you know, if you do these really stringent lockdowns, people are going to have to eat, right? So what happens? We're starting to hear anecdotal evidence of increase of security insecurity in some places. We're starting to hear people, you know, rising up and saying we're just not going to respect it because we need to eat, right? Mm-hmm. So there is a risk there, right? And so this whole idea of balancing the health and the economic crisis, it's not an easy answer. Let's be clear, it's not an easy answer, but it's very clear that places that are not infected, we need to keep them non-infected. That's very clear. So if you're not infected, you need to keep it. Places that have, you know, a lot of infections, we actually need to figure out how to contain that, right, and make sure it doesn't spread. And that's where the lockdown sort of comes into play, right? We have to do that, right? Because this is exponential, right? So, you know, after a certain time, then it gets completely out of control. And our health system is fragile at best, right? So, you know, what you want to do is make sure, you know, we see what happened in New York. Our health system is many, many more times more fragile than those regions. So I am worried about that if we don't get this under control, both on the health front, but also if we're not able to balance both the health and the economic crisis, our responses to both.
And so finally, as we look to, you know, the next 7 days, what will you be looking for? What will you be monitoring specifically?
Well, first, I'll be monitoring number of cases. Right. We have run an epidemiological model ourselves, right, to figure out, you know, what this could look like. Right. And in a situation where we don't take this thing seriously, and, you know, the London Imperial College has done theirs, if we don't take this thing seriously, we're talking about millions of cases. Let's just be clear. We're talking about millions of cases in Africa. Right? So we need to take it seriously. I'll be looking to see what governments are doing. So a number of going through sort of this gradual, we've closed schools, we've closed some of the, you know, limited gatherings. Some are doing partial lockdown. So what are the, you know, how do they respond, you know, as cases improve, as cases rise, how do, you know, what stringent measures they put in place that I'll be looking to see. I'm very looking forward to seeing next week after the World Bank IMF meetings, what, you know, what comes out of the package that the government that we've requested in terms of support from the bilateral partners. So that's I'm looking. And the last thing for me is looking about how we all behave, right? Social distancing, we all have to abide by it. If you want to bring the curve down. So those are a few things I'll be looking out for.
Actually, okay. It's so good to have your insight and expertise. Thank you so much. We'll be checking in with you in about 7 days from now. Thank you, Acha.
Thanks for doing this for us. Thanks, Acha.
You heard Acha there. You know, this is potentially a situation that could cost millions of lives if we don't take this seriously. We cannot say that enough times. And looking at the analysis he's done, he's calling for more robust action from our governments. No piecemeal action, but, you know, strong, robust, more urgency when it comes to dealing with the spread of coronavirus in Africa, looking at potentially 20 million job losses, talking about a massive impact that will hurt the vulnerable, would hurt those working in tourism and the informal sector. And the threat and the fear of all of us is that that will bring social instability, which we do not want to see on the continent. So this is the time for the bold action to be taken. Our governments have done a great amount and have moved swiftly, but, you know, clearly it is spreading, and WHO and African CDC are warning of, you know, the worst yet to come. So that calls for more action, and it's all about that balance between the protection and also understanding that this will cause real pain to people on the ground, people who are of limited means. And it's a balance. It's a very, very difficult one, which you heard Acha speak of, not one to be underestimated or to be flippant about. But the stakes are very, very high. Thank you for watching. I want to read some of the comments quickly that are coming in. And I'm so grateful that you take the time out to spend it with me, to share your thoughts. So I'm just going to read a couple of these quickly. And again, thank you to everyone. A lot of people just expressing concern about the severity of the situation. This one from Ababello: the low numbers could be as a result of low levels of testing, in reference to us not necessarily having a very clear picture of what's happening on the continent and the number of cases. people saying, being very complimentary about the show. Matilda Jallo, thank you so much for enjoying the show. This one coming in, Fatou Janna saying, Africa, our leaders are still sleeping and we have to wake up. Abiba again saying, this is a serious situation. Opunibi Akinkungbe, great content, outstanding guest. Thanks for doing this, Aisha. I'm just trying to do my part so that we all learn the information that we need to have so we can stay safe during this time. Thank you. Please keep the comments coming in. I'm going to read them throughout the show. I say it always, your voice is critical to what I'm doing here. I want to hear from you. Let's have this conversation. All right. This pandemic has thrown life into disarray. There's no doubt about it. As you know, at this point in time, about a third of the world is living under some sort of coronavirus-related restriction. In Africa, we've seen borders shut, we've seen curfews put in place, and we've seen restrictions to movement, these stay-at-home orders. It's immediately obvious that people are not able to move freely. That's obvious. But what may not readily jump to mind is the fact that it's also affecting the transportation of essential goods. And I'm talking about food. All of this is impacting food and food security. So we wanted to dig into this a little deeper. And I spoke to Selassie Asidika. She is a renowned chef, honed her skills in her mother's kitchen in Ghana, alongside kitchens in the US and also across the United Nations. She is an economist. She has deep insight and had some really fascinating things to say on this front. Take a listen. Selassie, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me on.
It's so good to have you with us. Let me start by asking you, how is this pandemic affecting people's access to food there in Ghana?
I think it's a partial lockdown, so people can still go to the grocery store and to the markets, but there's very limited movement. So I would say that probably access to fresh food, nutritious food, vegetables and fruits is probably lower now than it was before. People have stocked up on perishables, non-perishables, and we have a history of like sardines and corned beef and, you know, all the stuff that we used to put in our chop boxes when we went to boarding school. So people have that, but you also have to be careful because a lot of those things have a lot of like carbohydrates and starch, and that always, you know, it fills you up. But, you know, the gharis and stuff don't always have all the nutrition that we need. So I would say it's been challenging.
Yeah. Have you seen an increase in prices the way we have in other African countries?
Yes, mostly for the non-perishables, the ones that people can hold on to that, you know, they're not going to spoil right away. Those prices have gone up.
Mm. So you mentioned the fact that, you know, those things that we grew up eating in our lunch boxes, the sardines, the corned beef, you mentioned the starch, you know, obviously sodium as well becomes an issue, high salt content. You know, at a time like this, when people's access to fresh fruits and produce contracts and prices are going up, the concern has to be for nutrition and overall health, right?
Absolutely. And we have things like, you know, if you think about it, school feeding programs, they have lunches and everything provided at schools. And now that no one's in school, you know, children who were using these as their access to food no longer have that access. We don't have food banks like, you know, as part of our safety net that you would find in maybe a few other countries in the West.
I mean, what this really is shining a light on also is how much we don't know about where our food comes from, you know, and just, you know, the general kind of in many places around the world, kind of this level of ignorance around our food supply.
Absolutely. I mean, when I came back to Ghana, I started asking where a lot of things came from. And I quickly realized that, you know, a lot of our rice comes from Asia. A lot of our poultry comes from Brazil, China, other places. And so the question I'm starting to ask myself is, what is it going to look like in a few months when the countries that were our import partners are holding on to food for their own national security and food security? What does our food security look like? You know, in Ghana, we're starting to promote local rice, which is fantastic, but we haven't reached the local consumption needs. And we also need to sensitize people to, you know, wanting to eat local rice. Yes. So those are some of the questions that I think are going to start coming into play after the initial sort of acute part of the the pandemic, which is currently more about health, and maybe there's a little talk about economy, but I think in terms of national food security, what is that going to look like?
And for you, what are the, I mean, we're not quite at the lesson stage, but for you in terms of governments, I mean, certainly, yeah. what are the moments that should be brought into focus for them as they're making decisions?
I think that we need to start thinking about how to be self-sustainable. How can we make sure that we're able to feed the country? You know, right now, many African countries, we're growing cash crops and exchanging that for foreign trade to, you know, buy the food that we need. So I think in our histories, many of our countries, we've gone through phases where we've been trying to be more self-sufficient. And I think now it's like, how do we grow more of the food that we do eat? How do we get that maybe to a community level at schools so that we can supplement children's nutrition? How do we get that into households so families that are, you know, not even necessarily locked down, but can actually just go into their back gardens and pick things to add to the food that they're eating? Mm-hmm. I think it's a great opportunity for us to start thinking about that in the future. I mean, we've had crises in the past that have necessitated us to sort of bring this skill set forward, but I think we need to bring that back to the table again.
And it's one thing, you know, on the national level and putting in place the kind of frameworks to increase agriculture and locally grown produce. But I wonder, yeah, what's the situation in Ghana with regards to communities and young people wanting to get involved in, you know, in agriculture and in that side of things? Because what I've seen in Sierra Leone is, you know, as we talk about, you know, development and urbanization, more and more young people, you know, want to go to the city. Yeah,
exactly. It's not quite cool and hip yet. I think right now, there have been a movement. There are definitely some young people who have started going back into people who've, you know, maybe been working at banks who now see farming as the future. So it's started. We need to do much more. And I think, you know, when you're talking about access to land, access to water, because having the land is not the only, you know, piece of the puzzle. You need to have water to, you know, to water your crops. You need to have access to market. We're talking about, you know, access to food right now. There are farmers that have crops because, you know, they haven't gotten the memo about COVID, and the plants are growing and they're coming to harvest, and they're needing places and ways to access consumers, because right now we have a lot of middlemen that are the ones between the farmers and the consumers. And that conversation that we need to have as countries needs to be much more, as a farmer, how can we make farming successful and profitable to enable and encourage more young people to want to go back into it? What are the real challenges that they're having, you know, beyond sort of the psychological, oh, I want to move to the city, what are the other real challenges that it's going to take for us to solve together to allow them to really make things, move things in the country for us to be able to eat?
And back to this immediate moment and people's limited, yeah, choices, whether because of lack of access to the items themselves or because they're priced out of the market. I mean, what are some of, like, I guess, guidelines or maybe tips, I mean, in terms of people making better choices with, yeah, you know, with where they're at right now?
I mean, if you have options, I think try to make sure you eat as much nutrition from your food. So I know people are saying we all need to be healthy. You know, there's vitamin C, but there's, you know, in general, your body needs to be strong. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, trying to eat as many vegetables, colorful things. I always tell kids, especially, try to eat the rainbow. Have colorful things on your plate so that you know that you're getting all the nutrition you need. If you can't buy vitamin C, there are local solutions like baobab powder. You know, baobab is a fruit it's not expensive at all. And you mix that with water, and that's actually a lot of vitamin C that you can get. So you don't need to go to the pharmacy to buy that tablet. So, you know, we do have solutions. I think we might need to change some of the things that we eat. You'll go to the market and you'll see something you've never tried before. Today I loaded up on alefu, which is it's in the amaranth family. And that is, it's a beautiful green. You're probably not going to find some of the contumbres and the cocoyam leaves that you normally would find, but there are other greens that are available that someone has to offer. So it's also, you know, being a bit more experimental in what you want to select now, because maybe the normal thing that you would eat is not there. I've actually kind of started using more lentils and beans. Mm. So I'm not eating a lot of meat. You don't need to go buy chicken and fish and all those things. And it's making a lot of red, making aboboy, which is Bambara beans, and just using some of these local beans, soaking them overnight, and having other sources of protein in your diet and other nutrition.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me some tips and things I could be doing in terms of just eating better at a time like this, and for sharing what you know with our audience. So appreciate it. Please stay safe and come back and see us again.
Same to you.
Oh, thank you, Celeste, once more. Really interesting tips there. And you are watching in more and more numbers and sending your thoughts. I want to say thank you once more. I want to read out a couple of quick messages. We have people watching us from South Africa. We appreciate that. I was trying to find your name so I could tell everyone who it was from South Africa. Also got some people watching us from Brooklyn. And so we are grateful, Joseph Kanu, watching you from Pakistan. Thank you very much. A lot of messages about what's happening to Africans in China, particularly in Guangzhou province, which we've been reading about, that there have been large evictions of Africans, particularly Nigerians, being accused of bringing coronavirus into those areas. We're going to be covering that story next week. So please join us for that next week. We're going to bring you the view from China of what's happening there. So stay with us for that. Okay. These are uncertain times. There is so much confusion. People don't know which way to turn. They don't know what to do. It's just a lot of confusion. In the midst of this moment, and we've seen it play out over and over again in the past, there are always those who step up. There are always those who step up to do that little bit more, you know, those everyday heroes. And we think it's important on this show to shine a light on them, to acknowledge their efforts, and maybe even just in the hope that by telling their stories, other people will be inspired to do their part in these difficult times. In the case of our next guest, Noella Kosaris Musunka, she has been operating in the DRC for more than a decade. And while a lot of nonprofits have shut up shop for various reasons, she basically has kept going. And we want to shine a light on the work she's doing with her organization, Malaika. Noella joins us now. Hi, Noella, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
I can. Welcome.
Technology.
Was that your child I saw fixing your audio on your
computer? Yes, he was. He's my little helper on anything I need.
Well, we thank him for getting you on the show. And
he said he's going to come to say hi.
It's great to have you here. Let me ask you about Malaika. Just explain to our viewers what your organization was doing before COVID hit. I know you're working in the space of education and empowerment. Tell us more.
Yes, so we set up a foundation called Malaika since 12 years. It's really to empower girls and community through education and health program. It's really transformed from the ground an entire village. So we started to build a school with three classrooms with 104 girls. It's a free school, a leadership school, and now we have 346 students. So every year we were opening one more classroom, and they all have to arrive at 5 years old, and then we grow with them until they are 18. But when we started to build a school, because it's in a village called Kalibuka, where there's no water, where there's no electricity, before even building the school, you needed to build a well. And so many people every day were coming, hundreds of people were coming to fetch water from a well. And we were like, we cannot just do only a school. We need to really look at the needs of the communities. It's the reason over the 12 years we built 20 wells. And over the 12 years, now we have 346 students. So it's very an holistic program at the school. They learn to code. They learn. They have music. They have art. They have sport. They have breakfast. They have lunch. The nutrition program is very, very important because they maybe eat twice a week at their home. So we really wanted to make sure that when they come at school, they will be switched on, and we will look at how they progress with their health and their food. But FIFA was one of the donors of the school, and they decided after the World Cup 2010 to build 20 community centers, Football for Hope in Africa. So we collaborated with them to build one It's 600 meters of the school. And the community center really emphasizes education and health program and social development and social skills through sport. And we impact more than 5,000 people a year there. And it's really great because you cannot teach kids without teaching their parents or the community.
That's right.
So it's important that you have parents coming there. They learn basic literacy, how to read, how to write, entrepreneurship. And we grow our own food and it goes to the canteen of the school. And over the 12 years, actually, it become an ecosystem that the model we created, Malaika, can be duplicated in any communities in the world.
So let me ask you this, because, I mean, what you're laying out is an expansive, holistic program, helping not just the children themselves, but their parents, having full up community engagement. You were doing so, so much. What has COVID meant for your operations? Because I know that you know, the school has had to shut down, but that hasn't actually stopped your work. So tell me what you're doing now.
So the government in Congo has called the school and any community center or any public places to be closed. So we had to close like 10 days ago from the girls come at school and we have to tell them, you know, they're not exposed to TV, they're not exposed to news. It was very tough times because to tell them that the school will be closed for 1 month is a place where they always come. So we had to close the school and the community center. So what we decided to do, because the nutrition program is so important to our students every day, they were coming to have these meals at our school. So we decided to do a community feeding programs. Mm-hmm. So it means that we're feeding 60 families a week. They have to come, we're spacing out the time and the space, the social distance, and they come on Tuesday and Thursday, and we give them a pack of food. And in the village, we're doing, because we have 20 wells, at very strategic points, we do awareness about hygiene, mm-hmm. how to wash hands, we give them soap. And at the community center, we're making the mask that we're distributing to the communities.
And Noella, I mean, again, I ask you this question because I think it's always important to hear from people like yourself who are doing this work. Why are you doing this work at this point in time? You don't have to. You could be sitting in London just looking after your children and being with your family. Why important to you right now to be making a difference?
I'm very linked to the community. You know, I've been working 12 years there, so it's they're very close to my heart. And Malaika is one family. I will not be able to watch without helping them. Our donations are very low now because I think everybody is affected with donation. But we did an emergency fund, and a lot of our regular donors, some of them donated, and a lot of our friends and families to contribute to the meals program of the community and the student, and to really bring awareness with hygiene. So, you know, we're all comfortable here, but you're from Africa too. And so all these countries, it's a luxury to have water, it's a luxury to have soap, it's a luxury to have food. And we cannot just be sitting and not help.
Last question to you, to anyone who's watching this conversation and is saying, you know, I want to help, but I don't think I can. I don't have the skills. I don't have the background in this. What would you say to people who want to do something but don't know how to make a difference right now?
I think all over the world there is problems, in America, in India, in China, all over the world. I think you need to feel the cause that is the closer of your heart and either donate a skill to help or either to donate any amount that you have. That's where you feel that your needs can be. Because right now, so many people are losing their jobs, and it's very, very sad all over the world. But maybe they can give their skills to some foundations, because the problem in charity world, we, for instance, for us, we have to cut down all the hours of the international team. So that was a very, very tough time for us too. Me, I don't take any salary of my foundation. So I always been giving 6 hours a day. And now I have to step in more and give more hours, because I really want to make sure that we can keep alive the program we set up.
Yeah. Well, Noela Cosaras-Masunka, we are so grateful for the work you're doing there in DRC. You are an everyday hero. We thank you for taking time out to speak to us and for hanging out with me here at home. So thank you, Noela. Take care.
It's very nice to speak with you. You are my hero too.
You're kind. Thank you so much. And a big thank you to your son there for being, you know, our technical engineer. Thank you.
I told him. Wait 1 second. JJ!
My mother used to yell for me.
Wait 1 second, they're coming. They wanted to say hi, actually.
See, this is the beauty of doing the TV like this. We can wait and he can come.
Quickly, JJ Kaha.
Hello.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Lovely to meet you both.
Can you say hi?
Thank you.
We cannot see you.
Okay, well, we disappeared for a second, but thank you so much. Appreciate you. Stay safe, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, we go from the young geniuses there, because these young ones are so smart with tech, to this moment where everyone, the young and the old, involved and finding various ways to use technology to entertain us. We've seen, it feels to me certainly like endless hours of people doing TikTok online. I've seen endless dance routines flooding social media. There are others who are starting, you know, shows on these digital platforms like me. Yes, I'm one of them. You know, we're seeing everyone's taking the moment and they're using the technology at hand to entertain us, to keep themselves busy, to keep their routines going. It's not just ordinary people like, you know, you and I. Even presidents are getting in on the game when it comes to using technology to get their messaging out. Take a look at this. Why that brings so much joy to me. In case you weren't entirely clear who was doing laps back and forth in that opulent, spacious room, that was the president of Uganda, Yoweri Museveni, doing laps there, showing that, you know, he still got it when it comes to his exercise routine as they restrict movements in that country. So Museveni taking to, you know, digital platforms. But over on the west side of the continent, Liberia's president, George Weah, is also not sitting quietly. Take a listen.
Security, everything is possible. It could be your mama, your papa, brother and sister. Let's stand together to fight this deadly disease now. Walk on the world we're living.
George Weah there, singing. Now, it has to be said, though, he is singing. And it is a song around coronavirus and passing on important messages. But we just thought we'd show you how the various presidents are taking to the moment and using digital platforms to communicate with their people. But we do want to take you to Durban, South Africa as our final look at video that caught our eye, so we can show you how professional dancers are busting a move in these strange times. with then. The Flatfoot Dance Company, their dancers in and around their homes in South Africa, which is under lockdown. They are not passing up on the opportunity to still, you know, keep in shape, bust a move, and capturing it all on video. So if you're doing something unique at home that is something you could share, please send us the video so that we can get it on the show, because the show is all about community and we want to hear your voices and see what you're doing and how you're coping during this time. Okay, so we're going from dancing to another form of entertainment. We're turning to our bright side. And the next man that I'm going to introduce you to, he's Nigerian-born, US-raised. He's currently carving out his own platform on the hit TV show called Dynasty. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the show, Sam Adegoke. Did I say your name correctly, Sam? Because just before you give me that strange eye.
No, that was actually well done. Yes,
absolutely. I got it right.
Yeah.
Before we get into the conversation, I want to show some people, I want to show our viewers a little clip of your work. So let's pause and then we'll speak on the other side.
It's not every day that your mother marries your cousin, except maybe in Nebraska.
This is very big of you, Fallon. Thanks for being so mature.
Well, you know, that's me. Mature. So tell me, how did this whole thing come about? And please feel free to leave out anything that might make me sick to my stomach.
Well, when I was in the Alps, I heard Alexis had been in the hospital in Switzerland. So I popped over a couple times to visit.
You know what they say, timing is everything.
Wow. And just think, if Jeff and I had actually gotten married, he would have been your nephew and your son-in-law, you know, instead of your nephew and your husband. I just think that's amazing. Cheers. To love.
To love.
To love.
Sam!
Thank you. You didn't show the kissing part. You know, my mom is watching. You know, this is good. Why are you kissing white women? True story. So thank you for that. Thank you for saving me from that. I appreciate you.
Is that what she said when she first saw it, when she first saw you on the show?
I can't watch the show with my mom. She
really?
You know, my parents were conservative Christians and they were ministers.
Oh.
So like anything sexual is not happening now.
Sam, you went as far as you could go. I mean, you're on Dynasty's known for being racy.
She can't separate reality from what's happening on television, you know? There was a scene where, I don't want to spoil it for people, but I got injured.
Uh-huh.
You know? I got a bullet wound.
Uh-huh.
And I had a foolish mistake of watching that episode with my mom, you know? And she's, Jesus, no, my son, they won't take my son in Jesus' name. I'm like, Mom, I'm right next to you. I'm like on the couch. We shot that like 6 months ago. Everything is fine. Jesus is Lord, you know?
So, okay. So that's the situation when it comes to the acting. Your parents are struggling to maintain the balance between fact and fiction.
Yes.
How are you doing right now? Because you're obviously not home in Nigeria. How are they doing with, you know, you just being able to communicating and telling them that you're okay? Do they believe you? Or are you constantly on the phone having hour-long prayer sessions?
Yeah, no, we are definitely doing hour-long prayer sessions. My parents are actually, my family's in L.A.
Okay.
So my parents spend probably like 3-4 months out of the year in Nigeria and then the rest in the States. So they went to visit my other brother in Minnesota. So they're doing okay. You know, we have like family group chats that we do literally every day, constantly. They're sending me messages right now. So we're constantly in touch. We're doing Skypes. So thank God they're doing well and they're cared for by my brother, so.
That's really good. And how are you doing right now? I mean, how are you staying upbeat, you know, in these challenging times?
I mean, you know, it's tough. I wanted to go to, we shut down production a month ago from today, actually. So we didn't finish shooting the last two episodes. And I wanted to jump back on a plane, go see my family. They were doing some work on my house. Anyways, it took longer than I thought. A couple of days dragged on, and by then, LA was going on lockdown. So my family and I just decided, why don't you just stay put? So I've been here, you know, in this house by my alone.
So what are you doing? What are you doing, like, day to day? I mean, what is, tell me, because most people I speak to are constantly in their pajamas. Most
yeah.
People have given up on kind of personal.
No, I've been I actually showered and put on a t-shirt for this, but I've been in my pajamas. I'm working out, you know. I'm reading. I'm a big motorcycle head, so I jump on my bike and take a cruise just to, like, you know, clear my mind. I've been doing a lot of writing, which is really writing some indigenous African and Nigerian stories that I'm passionate about. And then we've also a couple friends of mine, you know, just talking about being here. You know, what can we do to try and reach back to the continent, you know, with COVID-19? You know, obviously we know that, you know, communities, like developing communities across Africa are going to be, God forbid, hardest hit by this. You know, we operate from a deficit. We don't have, you know, modern medicine. We don't have a lot of the things that even, you know, we think that those are at a shortage in the States. It's magnified exponentially in Africa. So to me, I think the biggest thing that we can do is prevention. So I knocked heads with a couple people, a good friend of mine at the Engage Africa Foundation, and we came up with this idea to try and translate like the basic COVID-19 prevention measures in as many languages as possible. So now I've done 16 languages and counting. We have Yoruba, obviously. We have Tigrinya, we have Hausa, we have Fulani. We even have one in Pidgin English that's hilarious.
What's your Pidgin like? Because you don't sound like someone who can speak Pidgin.
Oh, you're gonna choke me on television. Yeah. Right. I know you speak.
No, would I ask me? If I'm me talk Creole, me ready talk Creole and I'm ready challenge. Talk no more. I listen you now.
No vexo, auntie, forgive.
No, you begin, so talk now.
Oh no, I'm done. That's all I got. I'm not even gonna make the funk with you. That's literally all I got. It's all down here from there.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, the idea is that, you know, in these communities where English isn't a primary language, you know, we try and disseminate as much as possible, where possible, to share with them, you know, here's a prevention measure that you can take with the means that you have at your disposal.
So. And so for you right now, I mean, you also mentioned that you're writing, you put your head together with some people to do this translation. I mean, where are you drawing, you know, the inspiration from right now? Because a lot of people are watching this conversation and they are struggling to tap into their own wells of inspiration. It's just a difficult time. So where are you going? What are you turning to?
You know, I've actually, a lot of the reading I was doing prior to this break, the space that we have, was research for my projects, you know, like specifically watching things, like reading books. But I've actually taken a break from that and started like reading things that have nothing to do with what I'm doing. So I recently just read the book Children of Blood and Bone by Tomi.
I haven't read that yet, but I've seen reviews. Tell me more.
Amazing. It's like a young girl's coming of age story set in this fictitious mythical world in Nigeria. And it kind of pays homage to the ancient Yoruba deities, you know, Shango, Momiwata, and which is almost like Greek mythology. And
yeah. So
this girl is on this this journey to realize her own powers, and she has her own deity that she connects with that gives her these powers. And to me, that's amazing because, you know, growing up conservative Christian and probably in so many places in Africa, we're taught that this is, you know, demonic, that it's witchcraft, that, you know, these ancient forms of worship that we used to employ are bad. And this book just it gives kind of like this beautiful take on those. And it gave me inspiration in seeing one thing I love about Tomi is she's kind of unapologetically Nigerian in this book. Mm. You know, she'll use Yoruba and, you know, we just say my mom wore a gile. Mm-hmm. And we don't and go into any sort of explanation on what a gile is, you know. And as I've been writing some of my materials, you know, I've been trying to make sure that they can be digestible for American audience, you know, so you tailor things.
Yeah.
And I realize, oh, no, I don't have to do that anymore. It's time for them to come learn about us. They can Google. Yeah. You can Google what gile means, you know. So things like that are giving me inspiration to just see how other people are approaching their craft and their work. So I would encourage people to pick up a book, you know, grab a piece of fiction, something that can, you know, take you away, or a self-help book. There's a bunch of great ones out there. And then, you know, take a beat, take a walk and get back to creating.
I love that. We are going to be continuing this conversation on Instagram in a couple of minutes. So this is just a little taster for people. And then we're going to get into the real talk of exactly what you're doing in that house, because you're giving me all this like high-minded stuff about reading and like chilling. And probably you're just like wandering around eating Cheetos at 2 a.m. We want to get the real deal.
Definitely.
I'm going to see you on Instagram in about 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Okay, Sam Argeke there joining us. We will see you on Instagram. I'll be looking for your name to buzz you in. Thank you for joining us on Home with Aisha Sasay. And thank you for taking the time to spend this Friday with me. I hope you found it informative. I hope we've given you some inspiration. Hopefully, we've given you some inspiration to go jogging around your apartment, like President Museveni in Uganda, and also just a different perspective on what the coronavirus spread means for us in Africa. I'll be back Monday, same time, same place. I tell you all the time, I'm locked up in here, don't have anywhere else to go. Hope you'll keep me company, 12 p.m. Pacific, 3 p.m. Eastern, and that is 7 p.m. GMT. Hope to see you then. But before then, hope you'll join me on Instagram where we can really grill Sam to get the real deal on what he's doing at home during the lockdown in L.A. Stay safe, everyone. Take care. See you Monday right back here on Facebook Live. But till then, see you in a few minutes on Instagram. For now.